needed. So Acts chapter 26, we're going to start with verse 1. And I'm kind of going to paraphrase a little bit and kind of get into, I'm going to read like the first three or four verses, and I'm going to jump to verse 24, okay? And then you guys can kind of go back and read what was going on. So it says, "Then Agrippa said to Paul, 'You are permitted to speak for yourself.' So Paul stretched out his hand and answered for himself, 'I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because today I shall answer for myself before you concerning all the things of which I am accused of by the Jews, especially because you are expert in all customs and questions which have to do with the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to hear me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, which was spent from the beginning among my own nation in Jerusalem, all the Jews know. They knew me from the first, if they were willing to testify that according to the strictest sect of our religion, I live a Pharisee, and now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers. To this promise of our 12 tribes earnestly serving God night and day, hope to attain. For this hope's sake, King Agrippa, I am accused by the Jews.'" Now I'm going to jump to verse 24, all right? "So now, as he had made his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, 'Paul, you are beside yourself. Much learning is driving you mad.' But he said, 'I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak the words of truth and reason. For the king before whom I also speak freely knows these things. For I am convinced that none of these things escapes his attention, since this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you do believe.' Then Agrippa said to Paul, You almost persuade me to become a Christian.'" Amen? Amen. So I know, man, I read the first couple of verses of that chapter, and then I skipped down to the ending of that chapter. And here's the reason why. There's so much that's in the middle. But this is what's going on. Paul is taken in. He's accused by the Jews for a number of things. But in light of it, man, being a Christian, he is being accused of no longer following the Jewish faith and now preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And now he's standing before different councils and different kings and people of that nature. And so he stands before Festus. Festus, man, hears him out. And then King Agrippa says, "You know what? I would like to hear this guy for myself." And this is where it starts in verse 26. Paul is taken before King Agrippa. And when he's taken before King Agrippa, Paul starts to speak to him saying, "Hey, look, I know that you know the customs of the Jews. I know that you have a good understanding of Jewish culture and what the Jews believe. Matter of fact, later on, he even says, you believe the prophets. I know that you believe." You know, so, man, he knows that that King Agrippa understands the Old Testament. So, you know, we read that first part, and then it goes further in that he starts telling him of how he served God through his Jewish customs, man, diligently. He was a Pharisee, the strictest part. He was a Benjamite, and he did all the customs. Matter of fact, it came to the point where he not only was watching as Stephen was being stoned for what he was saying about Jesus Christ, but he began to persecute the Christian church as well. And as he began to persecute the Christian church, he had an order from the government or from the people to actually take Christians captive, both women and men and children, and put them in jail for their belief. And Paul was consistent and persistent on doing this very thing on his road to Damascus. And this is everything that he's saying in chapter 26. He says, "Man, on my road to Damascus, though, I seen the risen Lord. I seen Jesus for myself." And we read this earlier in the book of Acts, his encounter that he has with with Jesus, as Jesus appears to him while Paul is on the road to Damascus. And as he has this encounter, man, the Lord speaks to him of the things that he is called to do. He receives the revelation, man, that Jesus is the Christ, he is the Messiah, and that, man, he should no longer persecute the church, that he's actually called to be an apostle to the Gentiles. And so, in light of this, Paul is blinded for 3 days. We know the story that after 3 days, man, he's taken to another brother in the Lord, and as he's taken to this brother in the Lord, he prays for him. His eyesight comes back, scales fall off of his eyes, and now Paul is out there ministering the gospel everywhere that he goes. And as he's ministering the gospel, he's starting to catch a bunch of persecution. So whenever they take him in, after he gets arrested and taken in, now he's standing before King Agrippa. He's told all of this to King Agrippa. Festus comes in as he's speaking, comes in and says, man, you are beside yourself. All this learning has caused you to go mad. In other words, man, all this studying and all this, man, all your strict diligence, man, in learning, man, has caused you to go mad, become a crazy person, to believe and to be saying the things that you're saying. And Paul's response was, I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak the words of truth and reason. Goes back to King Agrippa and says, King Agrippa, I know you know the prophets. I know you believe them. I know you do. In other words, what he was saying was, look, I know everything that I'm saying is lining up with what you know about the Old Testament. And Agrippa's response was, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. And man, it blows my mind. It blows my mind. I started to think about a couple of things this week. First off is this, is like, why do we believe in Christianity over other religions? You know, some of us, you know, we actually believe Christianity because that's all we know. Like, that's all we've ever heard. We're in a Western culture, you know, we're in Western society. Christianity is the main religion here. You know, there's, you know, in the 80s, I don't remember, you know, growing up ever hearing about Islam or Hinduism or anything of that nature. You know, all I remember was Christianity, Jesus. Matter of fact, I remember starting to speak about Jesus whenever it would just come up at school. That, man, when I would hear about people who don't believe in Jesus, it would shock me. Not because I was a Christian or whatnot, but because of the fact that, man, I thought that's all there was. You know, was never taught anything else. You know, I was taught that Christianity is right, Catholicism is wrong, be a Christian when you grow up. Which a lot of us have learned that, or it was the opposite for some others. It was like, Catholicism is right, Christianity is wrong, be a Catholic when you grow up. Whatever the case may be, all we knew was Jesus. You know? And raising our kids now, you know, we raise our kids in the ways of the Lord. And I started to think, man, what about other people who were raised in other religions? You know, to them, their way is right. To the Muslim child, man, Islam is the right way to go. And so, it brings up this question, is like, man, what is right? Why Christianity over all other religions? Why Christianity over Hinduism, or why Christianity over Mormonism, or why Christianity over Islam? Why? These are questions, man, that when they arise, we should have an answer for. It's questions that you may not have because Christianity is all you know, but it won't be long before Western culture is shaken up even more by diversity in religion. I mean, we see in the last 15 years the diversity that has happened just in Houston. The rise of Islam Hinduism and even atheism, which, you know, in itself is its own religion. And if we don't have an answer to why are you a Christian, why do you believe in what you believe in, Why did you choose Christianity over any other religion? Well, you may not have chosen. That may have been the only choice for you at the time. But why is it now that when you see all these other religions, you stick to Christianity? Amen? These are questions that should arise within us. But not only the questions that should arise within us, but the desire to know the answers. Why Christianity over all other religions? We know through Scripture, we know when we read this book, that in the last days, man, there's going to be a lot of things that occur. There's going to be a lot of things that happen. There's going to be a lot of issues with religion, a lot of major issues with Christianity. You're not only going to see a great falling away of the church, but you're also going to see Christianity persecuted very heavily, which I might add happens very heavily in the eastern side of the world. And it may not be happening heavily in the Western culture right now, but mark my words, it will happen because that's Scripture. Now, not only that, we'll see the great falling away, but we're also going to see a number of things like one world government and one world religion. These are things that we have been taught, and yet, man, we need, as we start Scripture, we see them dimly through Scripture, and yet can still understand them as the Holy Spirit gives us understanding. That it's going to happen. And when I say a one world religion, it means this, that there's many roads to God. That if you're Muslim, you can still reach God. If you're Christian, you can still reach God. If you're Hindu, you can still reach God. And atheists, you just don't know what you're talking about, so you can reach God too. And that kind of thing. All roads lead to God. And that is not true. That's not true. You see, in order for something to be true, it has to be absolute. Truth has to be absolute. It cannot be relative. In other words, man, your truth and my truth cannot defeat each other. If your truth says, man, there's many. If I say my truth is true and you say your truth is true, but my truth says your truth is a lie, then which one is true? That wasn't a tongue twister. If you have your truth and I have my truth, and your truth says all truth is relative, all truth is fine, but my truth says your truth is a lie, which one is really true? Why is Christianity true? Why is Christianity the truth over all other religions? And why are other religions a lie? These are things, man, that we have to look at. These are things, man, that we have to know. Especially in these last days. Let me tell you something. This has been a very, very peculiar week for me. The different types of people I've been speaking to all week. The places I've been speaking to them at, and the conversations that we have had. And I know that if I would have went into any one of these conversations with, well, Christianity is true, and you just have to have faith to believe it. That would not be enough. Paul said, King Agrippa or Festus, I am speaking to the king with truth and reason. With truth and reason. In other words, man, not only, it's crazy because when Paul would speak, he would bring them down to and especially when he's speaking to the Jews, and he would bring them to a place where, okay, I know what you believe. This is why what you believe, the things that are in the Old Testament, relate to what I'm saying now. And sometimes the Jews' eyes would be open, and other times they wouldn't. We know through Romans that the Jews have been blinded, and that salvation has been given to the Gentiles, so that the Jews could look at the Gentile and be jealous for what God has done to them. And what does that cause them to do? Come back. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So forgive me. I was having technical difficulties this morning, so I will have just regular sheets of paper because I am ministering this morning. So We have, man, that all these religions that are going on in the earth. We know that truth, man, there has to, if truth is absolute, there has to be spiritual absolutes too. Amen? There has to be. And when we look at different religions, man, we can see in different religions, man, that there is, though they may say all roads can lead to God, though there's you say your way leads to God, and I say my way leads to God. There's some distinct things. You know, a lot of times when you look into Christianity, it's like people look at Christianity and say, why is it that it's only your way or no way? Why is it that it's only your way and no other way? Why can't Mormons be right? Why can't Jehovah's Witness be right? Why can't? Because, man, if that's the case, then truth is relative. Truth, man, is just whatever you say is true. Mormons believe that there's many gods. There's many gods. Not only believe that there's many gods, but believe that you too are a god. And will become gods. Well, the Bible teaches us different. Amen?
Amen.
Christianity teaches that there is only one God, and that you do not become a God. Matter of fact, in the book of Psalms, there is a reference where it says, and you will become gods. But when it's accurately translated, it means judges. Jesus actually even uses that reference in the Old Testament. And we know that when we go back and we translate that into modern English, he means judges. Not that he means that we're all going to be gods. And I say it like this. Whenever you see something in Scripture, when you see something in Scripture, one Scripture, when you hear a preacher preach on one Scripture, and it sounds so great, this one Scripture that they're preaching, you have to take the whole concept of Christianity. You have to take all of Scripture, and all of Scripture has to support what is being taught. I cannot preach one part of Scripture and say, no, oh man, as Christians, you'll never suffer. Man, he wants you to live a blessed life, you know. Look at Matthew, man. He says, man, blessed are the meek, you know, blessed are, and all these things. I can't go to, you know, the book of Giants says, man, he wants you to live an abundant life. And he's like, and say, see, so he doesn't want you to suffer. And yet, man, see that in Romans, that there's suffering involved in the Christian life. To see that when Peter is writing his life, there's suffering involved. So in other words, man, whenever you see a Scripture, whenever you read a Scripture, you have to look at it in the whole context of what is being said and what is being taught in Christianity. You get me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Am I boring you?
No.
Do I got your attention?
Yeah.
Okay, I just want to make sure. And so, man, when you see things like that, when you see one Scripture in the book of Psalms, and it says, man, you will be like God, you have to, yeah, it's okay to question that. It's okay to question. God, that doesn't sound right. Why doesn't that sound right? Because if I'm a God, I'm a messed up God. So you have to dig a little deeper. Dig a little deeper. What does that word translate to? What does that really mean? And then at that, man, what is in context? What is it really trying to say? Because when you read it in context, what it's really trying to say, and then when you read it in context, when Jesus uses it, you don't want to be gods. You don't want to be judges. Amen? Islam. And I'm throwing some things out there, man, so that we can see, man, how if their truth is the same as our truth and all roads lead together, well then why did these things contradict?
Right.
Okay. So, man, Islam. You see, Islam, man, I'm telling you, you speak to someone who believes in Islam, they'll tell you, we believe in Jesus. We believe in Jesus too. Jesus is good with us. We're good with Jesus. Has anyone ever read the Quran? No. When you read the Quran, you see Jesus all up in the Quran. But Jesus is not the Son of God in the Quran. Jesus is their prophet and the head apostle, so to speak. But he is not the Son of God. Matter of fact, in Islam it says, man, if someone claims to be the Son of God, they are a liar and do not believe them. There's a contradiction within their own writing. Because there's enough historical evidence. There's enough historical evidence that we have outside of the Bible that proves that Jesus and the disciples claimed him to be the Son of God. So we know historically that Yeshua said he was the Son of God. And then in Israel, they write and they say, man, oh, Jesus, yeah, we presume to be a prophet. He was a great prophet. But man, he was not the Son of God. And then later on, we say, man, if anyone calls himself the Son of God, then they are a liar and do not believe them. And yet, they teach that he's not God in the flesh, but Christianity says he is the Son of God, God in the flesh. Matter of fact, that's one of the foundational truths in Christianity, that if you don't believe this, you cannot call yourself a Christian. And this is one of those essential things. Remember we were talking about essential and non-essential? Remember, non-essential, like, hey, if you believe in speaking in tongues, awesome. If you don't believe in speaking, fine. That's not going to stop you from being a Christian or not. Those kind of things, those things that, man, we may believe differently in the circle of Christianity, and that's okay, because the fundamental truths, the things that we stand on, we all agree on, that Jesus was the Son of God, that, man, that he was born from a virgin birth, that he died, he willingly died on the cross for our sin, was dead 3 days, was resurrected from the dead, sits at the right hand of the Father, and will come back for his bride. Those are foundational truths. Those are things that we stand on. Amen? Amen. That was like a great place to shout and say, hallelujah, amen. Amen. Those truths I believe in. Why? Because, man, those things should excite you. Amen. Especially if you know how much evidence there is of those things. You have some religions that teach that we are reincarnated, while others don't. Some teach that there's a hell, and others don't. All these religions, man, that they have different avenues and different aspects and different beliefs on the afterlife. Someone is wrong. Amen?
Yeah.
Someone has to be wrong. Someone has to be wrong. So who is wrong? They can't all be true. If they cannot all be true, it cannot be true that all religions lead to God. Furthermore, if it means that some religions are at least false in their claims to reveal the true God or gods. Remember, truth doesn't contradict itself. It can never contradict itself. If God exists, he will not institute mutually exclusive and contradictory belief systems in an attempt to get people to believe in him. He is not the author of confusion. We read this in 1 Corinthians that he is not the author of confusion. God is simple. Amen? God is simple. We're the ones that make it harder than what it really is. But he is simple. And so, man, he would never contradict himself. Truth doesn't contradict itself. There's many things, man, that we can look at in Scripture. I mean, in Scripture alone, even about Jesus. And I'm going to take you through a little straw man of a couple of these things. And I want you to just follow with me in the Bible. Matter of fact, if you have a piece of paper and a pen or your cell phone, I want you to write down these scriptures. I want you to go and look for them yourself. I want you to see what Jesus did. All right? So there's many religions that have prophecies And there's many religions that men within those prophecies, they got some on point. Amen? In other words, they prophesied something, and when they prophesied it later on, it did come to pass. Man, we can sit here all day and argue about there's some witches and sorcerers and people of that nature that will say things, man, and they're right on, or they got it on spot, those kind of things. But man, there's only one that's been 100% accurate so far. Only one. And then not only that, I want to lay some things out for you on Jesus fulfilling prophecy, all right, from Old Testament to New Testament. There's only one that's been able to do it 100%. But the other thing is this, is that there wasn't just one writer. There wasn't one writer in the Old Testament. You have a number of men. A number of men through a time frame of so many years that all wrote about the same man, what he would do, and they didn't contradict each other. Many of them didn't know each other. And when they were writing it, they were inspired by God. They wrote down the prophetic word. So they weren't able to sit down at a table and say, you know what? So look, I'm going to write this. You write this. And make sure when it comes that he knows that this is first and then this is second. And there was no way to be able to do that. All right? You have these writings hundreds of years before Jesus ever came that he fulfilled. Let's look at a couple of them. That he would be born of a virgin. Isaiah 7:14. Matter of fact, will somebody turn to Isaiah 7:14 and read that one? We won't read all of them, but I want to read a couple of them because I want you to see. Isaiah 7:14. And then will someone else please turn to Matthew chapter 1, verse 18? Matter of fact, you don't have to turn to Matthew 1, verse 18. I'm sure we all know the virgin birth. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Who has it?
The Lord himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us.
Man, Isaiah prophesying and said, man, that this... And God is saying, man, I will give you the sign that, man, a virgin will have a son and his name will be Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. How about this one? Micah 5:2. Someone turn to Micah 5:2. Micah 5:2. Who got it? You got it?
But you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times.
And the prophecy in the Old Testament in Micah that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. And we look in Matthew chapter 2. Where was Jesus born?
Bethlehem.
All right. That he would be preceded by a messenger. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. We see that in Matthew chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. That he would be rejected by his own people. Isaiah 53, verse 3. We read this we see the fulfillment of this in John chapter 13. I'm sorry, in John chapter 7, verse 5, and chapter 7, verse 48. And then here's one that we all should know, that he would be betrayed by a close friend. In Psalm 41, verse 9. And in John chapter 13, verse 26 through 30, we see Judas meet Jesus with a kiss. In Zechariah 12, verse 10, it's prophesied that he would be pierced on his side. We see at the crucifixion in John chapter 19, verse 34, that they didn't want to break his legs. They broke the legs of the other two so that the other two could suffocate. When they're hanging on the cross and they're still alive, that was the whole torture of the cross. It wasn't just being hung up, it was the fact of being suffocated. That after a while you became so tired, you would just hang. And as you hung and could no longer lift yourself up, your lungs were spread out. And so therefore, man, you just begin to have loss of breath and have a slow, agonizing death. So they broke the legs of the two other men that were hung with Jesus so that they could just hurry up and suffer and die. And yet when they came to Jesus to break his legs, they said, man, he's already dead. And they said, well, pierce his side. Ain't that crazy? That these men who do not know scripture, who know nothing, after breaking the legs of the other two, said, man, he's dead, man. We don't have to break his legs. And they said, okay, just pierce him on the side just to be sure. And they pierced him on his side. And it says blood and water came out. Not even knowing scripture and yet it being fulfilled. The crucifixion itself, man, in Psalm verse 22, verse 1, Psalm verse 22, verse 11 through 18, the crucifixion that he would be hung. And in Luke chapter 23, verse 33, and John chapter 19, verse 23 through 24, we see the crucifixion. We see the crucifixion in all the gospel. But even outside of that, we know historically outside of scripture, through secular writers, that this Jewish man named Yeshua was crucified. He was crucified and had many followers. The resurrection of Christ, Psalm verse 16, verse 10. Psalm chapter 16, verse 10. We see the resurrection of Christ in the Gospels. It's crazy. It's crazy, all the things that he fulfilled. And not only that, look, I want you to know something. Right now, 100% fulfilled. This is not the only one. There's over 300 prophecies that Jesus fulfilled alone. Alone. With no help from no one. That he fulfilled it by himself. Scholars, theologians, they say, man, that the probability of one person fulfilling eight of these 300 and something of prophecies is like this. Half dollar coins. Stacked up 2 feet high across the state of Texas. Half dollar coins stacked up 2 feet high across the state of Texas. One person picking up one coin anywhere in the state of Texas and then placing it anywhere in the state of Texas, and the next person coming to pick up that same coin is the same probability of one person fulfilling eight of these 30 plus prophecies of Jesus Christ. It's impossible. It's impossible. And yet Jesus did it. That was just another great place to say hallelujah. Now, man, I wish Brother Stephen was here.
Right? Hello.
Hello.
Man, I'm telling you, there's so much. There's so much. There's so much that is there that we can hold on to. There's so much, man, that we can dig into to know what we believe. Have you ever tried talking to an atheist about the Bible? You ever tried talking to an atheist about God using the Bible? They'll be like, dude, you're using the very thing I'm arguing against. What else do you have? I know what the scripture says. What else do you have? There's so much more. There's so much more. Man, I'm telling you, there's so much evidence proving the life of Jesus, the things that he did. We also have the claims and the deeds of Jesus. Now, it would be one thing for a man to say that he is God or that he is the Messiah. Matter of fact, I was born in 83, and I remember seeing on the news plenty of people who have come up and said, I am Jesus reincarnated. Or I am the Messiah, I'll come back for my people. I've seen all these people. And I remember, man, when I was younger. How do you remember when you were in the world and you were doing your thing? And you had family members that were in Christ, trying to preach to you all the time, you never want to hear them. But then you hear stuff like this, and you're like, you start calling through, hey, so you think he's the one? You think he already came back? Because you don't know. You know what I'm saying? You're with the rest of... I remember, man, in 2000. Remember in 2000, they said, man, that was going to be because of the way that technology was run, that they were going to have these major disasters because computers didn't know the computers were going to be able to register to go to zero. They didn't know if it was going to go back to like 00 or it was going to shoot up to 2000. They didn't know what it was going to do, and so everybody was all crazy. And I remember because that was me and Sarah's first date. Yeah, we went out partying that night. We're like, yeah, the lights are gonna go off. We're like, oh, I'm crazy. I was like that. Sarah was like, well, this guy's crazy. So, but remember, like that was one of the things. And then what was it in 2012? The Mayan calendar, like, oh, the world's gonna stop, man. There had to have been a reason. They knew something. Da, da, da. And then you had this other dude. Who was a supposed Christian, who was a mathematic genius, and he figured out through dates and times and names the specific time. All these people, and then even further, you have people like David Koresh and just people who are just said, and I am the Messiah, I'm the one. Jose Luis, who has followers from all over the world, who he preaches. Matter of fact, his interviews, he has half-naked women behind him, smoking a cigar, expensive suit with this big old desk, and he's like, yeah, I'm Jesus reincarnated. Fool, Jesus would not look like that and be doing that. Better put some clothes on, girl. He wouldn't be doing that. You know what I'm saying? We know that because we know the character and nature. I know some of y'all be like, now wouldn't Jesus be like that? No, he wouldn't be like that. He wouldn't. It contradicts scripture. And we know that. But many have claimed to be Jesus. They claim to be the Messiah. Many have claimed to be God. And so, man, just because they claim it doesn't mean that it's true. It's like, man, you remember back in high school, the loud ones? They were always loud. But when there's no teachers around, they were the quietest ones. Because you say a lot, but there's no action behind what you do or what you say. Jesus was very different than that. You got to look at the claims and the deeds of Christ. He says Jesus used the divine name for himself, John 8:58. The same divine name used by God when Moses asked God, what is my name? What his name was in Exodus 3:14, which was, I am. I am that I am. I'm him. Jesus said he could do whatever he saw God the Father do in John chapter 5, verse 19. And he claimed to be the one with God the Father, John chapter 10, verse 13, and John chapter 10, verse 38. And then even the disciples called him God, and so you have these claims that Jesus, a lot of times people would say, man, Jesus never called himself God. And he called himself that plenty of times. And you know, when you read in the Gospels and he keeps calling himself the Son of Man, the Son of Man, you know, he's not saying that for no reason. Because when you go back into Daniel, he's referring to. And he's referring to himself, man, as God. He's making that claim. But man, just because you make the claim doesn't mean that it's true. See, if Jesus would have came, said he's the Son of God, and not did anything else, then you would have to call that into question. Amen? We would really have to call it into question. But here's some of the things, man, that Jesus did. Jesus changed water into wine. John chapter 2, verse 6 and 10. I know most of y'all know that one. Jesus cast out demons. Matthew chapter 8, verse 28 through 32, and Matthew chapter 15, verse 22 through 28. Jesus healed diseases. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, and Luke chapter 6, verse 17. Jesus healed the paralytic. Mark chapter 2, verse 3 through 12. And Jesus healed the lepers. He raised the dead. He restored and cured deafness. He fed the multitudes multiple times. Not just one account, but many times. He walked on water. Jesus calmed the storm with a command. You see, Jesus did not just call himself the Son of God. What y'all laughing at? Jesus did not just call himself the Son of God. He came with the deeds. He did what he said he came to do. He not only came as the Son of God, he laid it out there, man. He did. He brought heaven to earth. Amen? I'm glad finally someone's getting excited in here, all right? So,
hallelujah.
That's not all he did, though. That's not all he did. Now, we can look historically, and there were some people, man, that wrote, man, like Yeshua, you know, or Christus, the Jewish man that, you know, that did many things. As a matter of fact, historically, some of these secular writers didn't know how to actually didn't know what it was, and so they called it, you know, mystical magic. They didn't know how else to write it. This dude going around just doing things we've never seen. And Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus rose from the dead, and it appeared to many people. And this is very important. This is very important. And this is why it's very important. You see through all the Gospels, you see the 12 following Jesus. You see them with Jesus whenever he heals the sick, whenever he raises the dead, whenever he raises the dead, when he cleanses the lepers, when he does these powerful things, when he brings heaven to earth, you know, all these great things, they're there. They see these things. They're excited. Matter of fact, there comes a point in time where Jesus asks Peter, man, who am I? And he said, man, you are the Christ. Like, we come to believe. We come to believe that, man, you are the Messiah. You are the Son of God. And then we see the scripture that Jesus tells him that, hey, look, you didn't get that on your own. The Father revealed it to you. Your eyes have been opened to see the truth. You have these, not only that, you know, Jesus wasn't the type of like, look, follow me and you know, just be quiet. Don't say nothing. You know how like when we walk, we got our kids and we're still on there. Hold my hand. Jesus wasn't like that. Some of y'all are not like that. I'm just like, I don't know what you're doing. Anyway, so you see at a point in the Gospels where Jesus says, okay, now everything you've seen me do, go and do. Everything you've seen me do, go and do. 27. All this stuff. And then not only that, throughout the Gospels, you see Jesus saying, I'm going to leave you guys. I got to die. I have to go. There's going to be a point. One of you is going to betray me. And they're still like, hey, yo, so who's going to sit on your side? They couldn't get it. They couldn't see someone taking Jesus. They seen Jesus walk through crowds of people rioting against him, ready to stone and kill him. And he would walk through the crowds without even being seen. Some type of fourth dimension type of stuff. You know, it's crazy. And so Jesus talking this crazy stuff about, man, I gotta die, I gotta. And they're like, no way. No way. Peter even said, man, anyone who tries to come against you, they're gonna have to go through me. Right? Then we see Judas comes, betray him with a kiss, the soldiers grab Jesus, Peter get all crazy, pull out the sword, start throwing up gang signs. Takes an ear. Jesus takes the ear and puts it back. Man, you live by the sword, you die by the sword. The miracles and the things that even they were able to do did not sustain them to stay with Jesus in the midst of his suffering. They scattered. It wasn't the miracles that kept them. It wasn't that they could do miracles that kept them. They were torn because, man, the one that they found all their hope in was now being taken to be beaten and crucified. And matter of fact, scripture says that they went back to fishing. They went back fishing. In other words, man, they went back to their old ways. They lost hope. They didn't know what else to do, so they went back to their old ways. And then Jesus rises from the dead. And we see this account. We see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul gives us a list of the amount of people that had seen him. You know, first the women, then the 12. You know, and then by the 500, all the people that seen him. You know, what's crazy is that when Paul is writing this, we know that there was people that were still alive in that same time frame that could have denounced this and said, no, that's not true.
We were there.
Yeah, they were there. And so, man, when he writes this, man, he's writing down, he's writing it down as a historical event. This really happened. We see that, but we also see something significant in the apostles, the ones that seen Jesus do miracles and did miracles themselves and watched Jesus do crazy things, and they did crazy things themselves. And then when they seen Jesus die, man, he scattered. But when Jesus resurrected and he was seen by the women and then Peter and then the 12, something happened. There was a boldness and a confidence within them that they were willing to die for what they believed in. That they were willing to be tortured for what they believed in. Matter of fact, they took it as an honor to suffer the things of Christ. Who would do that for a lie? Who would do that for a lie? We can search historically, just historically, put the Bible aside, search historically, and we know historically that all the apostles, minus John, who was exiled and left to die and was boiled in water, all but John suffered a martyr's death, died for what they believed in, and died faithfully. Died, man, as if it was an honor. You see a huge change from these weak-minded men who scattered the moment they see Jesus taken. When he told them, I'm going to be taken, but I'm coming back, and I'm going to give you a helper. To men who see the risen King, filled with the Holy Spirit, and now are ready to face death head on. To write scriptures like, oh death, where is your sting? You see, men, so much in the resurrection itself. You see so much in the resurrection itself that, man, how could you? How could we take this, man, and it not be true? There's so much that's laid out as evidence. There's so much, man, that we can look at. Not even to mention that religion in itself, man, if we look at all religion says, sacrifice your life for your God, and you might have a chance. Because there's no assurance in any religion. And yet there is one that says God will sacrifice himself for you. And you just have to trust in that hope. You just have to trust in that blessing. That's it. That he will make you a new man. You have religious systems that are set up to keep you in line, to keep you praying this many times a day, and this direction, doing this, and saying that, and going here, and giving this, and all of this stuff. And yet there's one that gave himself for us without us doing anything. And evidence of a transformed heart, of the one, man, that are able to live righteously, honorably, and boldly for what they believe, in love. Do you know what's separating the Christian circle from the rest of religion during the first church? Man, they were known for their love. They were known for loving people. They were known for their boldness to speak the truth, even in the midst of persecution. You want to know what the third was? They were known for their sexual purity. Because all the other religions practice some kind of immorality in their religious ceremony. Allowed immoralities in their religious life. And yet one Christianity. Christians were known for their sexual purity. I want you to think about this. We're in the West, and we think it's pretty crazy, sex-wise, around here. Think about in that time when it was just so open that it was even part of religious things. When it was just normal to have groups of people and just be out there. There was no problem. See, we don't see that because, man, we've had the mindset and the mind frame of Christian culture. But imagine the reverse side. Imagine if that's what you were brought out of. That you were used to that, and now you live pure. Now you live with the mindset of remaining clean. This is what they were known for. You know, Jesus could have said that. He could have said that, man, I'm going to rise. I'm going to have a spiritual resurrection. He could have said that. He could have said, man, I'm going to have a spiritual resurrection. And there's no way to disprove it. There's no way to disprove if it really happened or not. But Jesus went further. He went further and saying, I'm going to physically. Going to physically resurrect. I'm going to do the impossible. You can search any religion. You can search any religion. not going to find that same amount of truth. You're not. Why Christianity over any other religion? There's so much truth. There's so much evidence. So much. There's just too much. Prophetically. Historically. I'm a low-key geek. For real. I love studying. I love researching. I love doing all that stuff. And one of the things that I really love, and I'll put it out there, is a little math. I love archaeology. I love archaeology. I could go to museums and look at dinosaur bones and mummies and all that stuff all day. All day. I've always wanted to cut open a mummy and see what's inside and do all that. I know I'm weird, whatever. You're weird too. Love you. But I love that stuff. Like, I love that. And I'm telling you, we go to the museum, me and the girls, and I'm the biggest kid in there. So I'm just like, I'm in awe. I'm in awe of all these things. You know, where they found them and how they found them. And you would be amazed at how, at biblical archaeology. You would be amazed at some of the things that they've been finding in this last 30, 40 years. You know, and they have no historical evidence of King David. There's very little. I mean, to none. There's other than the Bible, there's no evidence of Goliath. Right? And yet, man, you know, here, I'm not even going to put a date. I know let's just say within this last 10 years, they were excavating, they found this bowl. And on this bowl, it was written on there, Goliath. That was his bowl.
That was a big bowl.
they found burial sites. They found cities. Where, when you look in the Bible, it's like, well, where are these cities now? We don't know where they're in. They're finding a lot of these things. And I encourage them. They have some really good arguments. I sit with people who do not believe in God, and I let them talk. And I'm like, I didn't even have those questions when I didn't believe. And man, they stir me up. They stir me up to search even deeper. And they should do the same thing for me. We shouldn't be afraid to talk to people who don't believe in God.
Right.
As a matter of fact, a lot of Christians try and avoid those conversations. You know? Matter of fact, a lot of us don't even know how to have a simple discussion without it turning into an argument because you don't believe in what I believe. And the truth is, we should all speak the words of truth.
In love.
We should all. Do you know it's not just the pastor's responsibility to tell this stuff? Amen. It's yours. I hope this morning stirs you up to just dig a little bit deeper, to search a little bit deeper. I hope, man, that the foundation you stand on is a little firmer today when you leave. And that some of the truths that were just spoken here today, that not only that you can rest a little easier on them, but that it would also cause you to want to dig for yourself and see what more is there. Because there's so much that's out there. And I'm telling you, the moment you start digging in this direction, look, because I know what kind of church we are. Let me be real with you for a little bit. I know what kind of church we like. I know what we like. We like the healing. We like the awesome stuff. You know, we like a lot of the feeling. You know, we love the presence of God. And I love all those same things. And also understand the balance that needs to be there. Like, understand the balance. Because when there's no balance, when there's no balance, either direction, you can fall into some very dangerous grounds. And so there has to be this balance. Jesus had balance. I know it's hard to believe that, but Jesus had balance. He
walked on water.
Yeah. And he didn't fall. So there's a lot of balance there. No, that's not what I meant. But that was such a good point. We had to ride with it. I'm going to say this, and then I'll end. He spoke the truth of God and demonstrated the truth of God. And he didn't demonstrate the truth of God just in miracles. He demonstrated it in his life. He demonstrated it in how he lived. Okay, and so there has to be that balance. There has to be. We should be excited for miracles. We should be excited for healing. We should be excited for apologetics too.
Hey.
We should be. Why? Because, man, it reaffirms and it helps in the argument. And when I say the argument, it helps in the discussion when we're speaking to people. That we know the answer. We have an answer. And there's grace on it. You know what I'm saying? We have to know. And then this morning, let's stand up. This morning, I'm always.